TheYeshiva.net.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome. The Baal HaTanya would often say a maimer, a discourse, and a few days later, or the next Shabbos, he would say a biur on the maimer, which would be a follow-up, a sequence, an explanation. Usually, in those biurim, sometimes he would explain and elaborate the concept much more, or often he would do that. He would also reference it and show how he developed ideas from their original source in the Chazal or in the Sfarim of Kabbalah and Nistar. And sometimes he would dissect some of the details much more. And the biurim are usually much more intricate, much more profound, a little more, sometimes a lot more, a little more complicated. And that's what you'll see in Torah Ohr. Well, the Kutta Torah, there'll be a maimer, and sometimes afterwards we'll say biur. Biur al-Hanal, or biur, which is a second maimer, which is a follow-up that was usually said a few days later in the next Shabbos. This maimer that we have been learning, Mayim Rabban Leyuchlu L'Chabbos Asav and Parshas Toldos, was said on the Shabbos before Purim Tovkov Samach Tes, at a wedding of a grandson. Which is why the connection was the Yitzchak Metzachik as Rivka Ishtoi, the whole connection between Yitzchak and Rivka. I think actually, usually when they would write them, the brother of the Alter Rebbe who wrote most of the Maimonim didn't write the details of when it was said. But the Tzemach Tzedek, he always, very often, he writes the details. So on this Maimon he says that it was said in one of the people, one of the Kisveyad, one of the men who says, Torah and Amer Shabbos Lefnei Purim, Al Chasen Asnechdoi Tovkov Samachtes. It was a chasen of his grandson. Probably the wedding itself was Friday, as they used to do. So Shabbos was the Sudas Achasen, Shabbos before Purim, and the Baal HaTanya said this maimer. Samach Tzedek says, Chasen as Ben Doidi Reber, chasen of my cousin. In other words, another grandchild of the Baal HaTanya. And then, apparently, a few days later, or the next Shabbos, perhaps, we don't know, he said the biur on the maimer. I don't think we ever learned a biur. All the maimonim we learned in Torah Ohr, we learned the maimer itself, not the biur. But this time, we'll do the biur. We finished the maimer itself. The last paragraph is more references, Maimer Mekaymus and Aris. So we're going to go now to the biur on page 37 of Daf Yutes. Now, this is a complex maimer. This is not such an easy maimer. It explores a very profound idea in Teres HaNister and in Teres HaChsidus. And that's the world of Das. There's a lot here. There's a lot here. And let's see. Let's begin the biur. Now, in order to really appreciate the biur, he takes the first maimer is going to go to another level. In other words, it's a biur on the first maimer, and he reveals, you could learn the first maimer and learn it and even understand it to some degree, but the biur shows certain layers of understanding and depth in the first maimer that wouldn't have been clear without the biur. So therefore, to really appreciate the biur, I'm going to encourage those who can't to chazer the maimer that we learned. You have it also online, so you could chazer it yourself with the shiurim on the yeshiva.net with the source sheets, but then you'll be able to appreciate the biur much more. So he says, Biur al-Hanal, an explanation on the above, al-Hanemer le'el, or Aniska al-Nidber le'el, Anemer le'el, Aniska le'el. Lahavim biur advarim, al-Posek imitin ish eskolein beise ba'av. To understand more the explanation of the ideas that we explain on the Posek in Shehashirim. If somebody will give all of his money, the money of his home, the wealth of his home for love, Bais Yavuzulai. And he explained, Hine, im hulashin kasher. That im doesn't only mean if, it means when. It's one of the meanings of im in Lashon Kodesh. Sheyesh im shein meshamshim b'loshon sofek ala b'loshon vada k'mayim kesef talvi v'miyya ha-yoyvel shein ze loshon sofek klal ala shebevada yiyya ha-davar v'yavoy v'loshon im eni ala loshon kasher. Which he said in the first maimer that sometimes in Chumash In Tanakh, im doesn't mean if. Im kesef talvin, parchus brum, doesn't mean if you will lend money. A Jew is obligated to do gmilas chesed, to help somebody in need with a loan. Im means when you lend, and then the Torah discusses the halachas, for example, not to lend with interest, etc. Or layiyah kanoisha over there. You shouldn't go and demand payment if you know it's making him uncomfortable and he doesn't have. V'im yiyah ha-yoyvel, if yoyvel will come. Doesn't mean if. It's going to come the 50th year. There's nothing to do. You can't stop the clock. It means for sure it's going to come. It's just kasher, one of the meanings. Pidush, kasher kasef talvas on el yisiyah lo'ikanosha. V'chein kasher yiyah ha-yoyvel. This and this should be the halacha. K'moykein im yitinish. Based on this, we can teach im yitinish, not if. As the normal, ordinary interpretation, but when, pirush, and this is what we explain, kasher yitin ish, sheyitin bevaday, when the man is going to give as kol hoin beisai, all of the wealth of his home, he's going to give all the richness of his home. It's going to happen for sure. And we explain that vahainu la osid, sheyitin uloshin osid, shela osid lova yitin ish as kol hoin beisai, that in the future, when Mashiach comes, as he said in the Zman of Tchiyas HaMeisim primarily, Ish, the one that we refer to as Ish, is going to give as kol hoin beisai, all the richness of his home, ba'ahava, for this love. Shebizman hazeh, this time, enei baladei gilu liyas p'china zush yitin as kol hoin beisai. Now, it is not manifested and revealed that he's giving as kol hoin beisai, even though it's there. Shabiz kiim la asidafka, in the future it will be revealed. V'ha'inyin, the explanation was. Kihina yahoin beisai, the wealth of them, hainu kamei ha'oitzis v'admatmainim shamanachim b'taych ha'bayis. Hoin bayis is not just a person's assets. It refers to all the treasures, like all the matmainim, everything that's hidden, all the secrets, all the hidden treasures inside the home. Kol hain beisai means everything in the home. While derech mashakasuv, this is similar to what the pasuk says in Mishle, perik chav galad or chav gimel, where the pasuk says that he quoted earlier, b'chachma yibana bayis, a home is built through chachma, ubitvuna, and through tvuna yiskoinan, the home is established, through chachma the home is built, through tvuna, through understanding, the home is established, yiskoinan. And then Shlomo HaMelech continues in the next pasuk and says, ubidas, and through das, Chadarim yimalun kol hoin yakar v'noyim. The rooms, the chambers, the chadarim of the home will be filled with all of the precious and sweet, with numerous precious and sweet, pleasant treasures. That's the kol hoin beisai. And as he explained earlier, that's the remez of kol hoin beisai, that all of the hoin and the bayis, which bayis, as he said, were oisis atayra, because Isis are called Avonim. You remember, Isis are called stones, which build words, which build home. It's a form of construction. So, the Talmid HaChamim, the Gemara calls Banoyim. They build, because they build the world through Isis HaTorah. Isis are Batim. And Kol Hoin Beisai was, Torah is Chachma, Torah is Bina. But then there's the Das of Torah, the Tainug of Torah, the Hoin Beisai of Torah. And the Tainug of Torah, that's what's Yitin Ish is Kol Hain Beisai, that's what he's going to give Ba'ava. That's what he explains. So he says, V'hine Ksiv, B'chachma Yibon Abayis, B'svuni Yiskoinon, U'bedas Chadarim Yimalein, Pirush, B'chachma Urak Etzem Binyan Abayis Levad. With Chachma, you build the home itself. Shein Oisis HaTorah, Shenikroyim Batim Kenoi. This refers to the letters of Torah, which are called homes. Like we said, every few letters creates a word, which means this construction. A letter is like a pebble or a brick, and together the letters put together a word. Ubitvuna yiskoin and pidish iker kiyum v'amadas tavnes v'toychen abayis b'ri b'chadarav v'mutzavim v'vavodeh binadavk. And then it's established through tvuna, which represents bina, which means the maintenance and the establishment of the tavnes, the structure of the home. The theme of the home, the many rooms, the pathways going in and going out is through Bina. The very building, the foundation is Chachma. And then Yiskoinan, the establishment of it and all of its details and intricacies is Bina, as we will see. Aval b'das, but then one needs das, yimolun kol achadarim bohen yoker, that's what fills all the chambers with precious richness. And that's the hoin beisai that is here presently through Torah mitzvahs, but will come out begilui in a revealed way, la'asid lovay. This is what was said in the previous maimer, but he did not elaborate at all on this chachma and the bina and the das and the connection to the home. He said it very bekitzer, the second to the last paragraph, and from there he went to the concept of bois yavuzaloi, as we explored in the shiurim on that maimon when we learned it. Olahavinus calls that to understand all of this, which before it's like in passing, he says chachma bina das, das is tainug, the tainug in toira, the lakus in toira, shayolim is yudshin, is yokar, is yudshin, im yitin ish, is aleph yudshin, knei chachma, knei bina, he said, knei is begamatria yudshin, etc. So he says, lahavin kolze, tzorich lahakdim hakdama achas, bebir inyin seder ishtarshlus, di yutzviris datzilis echusidrum vayfam. To understand all this, we have to bring a hakdama, an introduction. And this introduction is going to discuss one of the concepts known as one of the concepts in what's known as Seder Hishtalshlus, the evolutionary process of the 10 spheres of Atzilus, Eichu Sidrum Vaifanam, how their order and manner functions. Now here he's going to discuss what would seem a classic Kabbalistic theme, a theme from Kabbalah, from Sifrei HaKabbalah, which, as you will see immediately, here you'll have a very vivid example of how Nister of Torah, how Pnimis HaTorah evolved. He's going to explore a theme that's in Kabbalah. At first glance, it seems completely coded, code language, extremely abstract. It's mystical. It deals with things it's very hard to relate to. It's not tangible, doesn't seem tangible. It gets into a whole, so to speak, not mathematical, but like mathematical in terms of structure, where this is, where that is, where that is. Anyone who's familiar even a little bit with the Svarim of Kabbalah, of Pnimis HaTorah, sees this language all the time. But the language is extremely mystical, extremely coded. It's very, very beremes, very hinted. And then the Baal HaTanya is going to take these very concepts and first of all try to explain them according to in a oifer of his shitta, which is chachma bina das, which he's discussing, chachma bina das, in a way that's more understandable, and more importantly, equally importantly, apply it to life, what it represents in a person's life. So let's see. Seder hishtalshelus, just translation, means the word hishtalshelus comes from the word shalshelus, evolution, a chain. One rung follows another rung. Unlike a chain, it's just separate rungs, you put them together. But each rung is a replica of the other rung. Spiritually, Seder Hishtalshelus means the evolution of divine energy from its highest place until it reaches this world. That's called Seder Hishtalshelus. Yud Sviris of Atzilus, I'm saying very, very bekitzer, very briefly. Yud Sviris of Atzilus. Kabbalah, it's explained that there are generally four worlds. Generally, Atzilus, Briya, Yitzira, Asiya. Our world is the world of Asiya, the world of action. Above it is the world of Yitzira, formation. Briya, creation. And Atzilus means, from the word Eitzel, oneness, the world of intimacy, of closeness. And when we say four worlds, it doesn't mean four separate worlds. You take a spaceship and you fly 100 million or 100 billion light years away, you'll hit Yitzira. Then you'll do 300 billion light years, you'll bump into Briya. And then you'll crash into to Atzilus, and by that time you won't know what hit you. For good reason. When we speak four worlds, the four worlds are not in four places. They're all in the same place. It's ultimately four perspectives on every reality. There are four worlds. We're talking about spiritual worlds, meaning spirituality is not limited to a certain place. Atzilus is here, Briya is here, and Yitzira is here, and Asiya is here. And Asiya itself, you have the spiritual world of Asiya, you have the physical world of Asiya. We inhabit often the physical world of Asiya, and each world evolves from the other world. In other words, Atzilus and Asiya are not two separate worlds. One evolved, that's called Seder Hishtalshelus. Each world is generally made up of building blocks. In chemistry, Lahavdil, you have the building blocks of everything. Yeah. A drop of water, right? A molecule of water is made up of two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen. That will be the building blocks of water. When you look at water, you just see water. But if you dissect it, it's made up of atoms. Every single molecule of water is made up of atoms, but each atom is made up of what we call subatomic particles. I'm just trying to explain that there's the chemistry of everything, and you could go further and further and further and dissect it more and more and more until you get to deeper, deeper, deeper layers, until you get to its core. The building blocks of every world is made up of what's called 10 spheres. Spheres means numbers, like Mispar. It also means lights, like Sapphire, Evan Sapin. Characteristics. 10 spheres, which means 10 divine energies, 10 divine lights that make up the world. Those 10 spheres are well known. Usually they're defined as Chachma Bina Das, Chesed Gvura Teferis, Netzach Hoyd Yisoydin Malchus, and Spheres HaOmer, the 7 weeks, Mos Sidurim, and Kehillas go through the 7 middas. Those are the last 7. Before that, there's Chabad Chachma Bina Das. Very often, we count Keser. In many of the lists of the spheres, you'll count Keser, Chachma Bina, Skip Das, Chesed, Gvura, Teferes, Netzach, Chod, Yisoid, Malchus. We'll soon see one. Those are the 10 spheres. Kivayachal, it's the way Hashem, if I want to summarize it in one sentence, it's the way the infinite, the Ein Sof Hashem, identified with his, which within his infinity, 10 manifestations, 10 characteristics. As it says, the Arizal says, there could have been 1,000 spheres. There could have been infinite spheres, infinite manifestations. But these are 10 ways in which Hashem chose to identify or reveal his infinite light. They're manifested through 10 methods, through 10 venues, 10 characteristics, 10 midos, 10 attributes, whether it's Chachma, Bina, Das, and they are the building blocks of the universe, of every universe, including our universe, and of everything in the universe. Nasa Adam B'Tzalmeinu K'Dmuseinu Al Pi Kabbalah means man, a person was created in Hashem's image, that we're also made up of the 10. That's why it says in Tanya, in many Svarim, in Nefesh HaChaim, in many Svarim, that every soul is made up of 10 characteristics. There's the Chachma in you, and the Bina in you, and the Das in you, and the Chesed in you, and the Gvura. Now some people are more oriented towards one sphere. There's Bali Chesed, there's Bali Gvura, there's Bali Teferes, there's Bali Netzach. You have to know who you are. But each soul is made up of all 10. Those are the 10 building blocks of the universe and of every single soul. So it says, we make man in our image, B'Tzalmeinu K'Dmuseinu, which according to the Zohar and according to the Arizal and many others, this refers to the 10 characteristics. So he says, we want to understand something about this evolutionary process of Yud Sviris of Atzilus. Now, I'm very well aware that people who hear these things for the first time, it's like you want to shut down. It's like, okay, this is above me, this is beyond, it's not Negea. So this requires a little diligence to be able to stay the course, as they say, and you'll see that things become clearer as we move on. I just wanted to specify what these words mean. Once you become familiarized a little more with the terms, then you see this really as a very useful vocabulary in order to describe basically everything that goes on inside. So he says, "Matzinu b'zeh b'divriyam mekobalim shnei yefanim shalachayim kemat hafcha." In the words of the mekobalim, this his encyclopedic mastery of all aspects of Torah, nigler etmanshenish, you see in Shulchan Aruch Harav, but also pnimiyus haTorah was something extraordinary, to the point that when Baal HaTanya would speak, all the svarim of both of nigla and nister came together. So he says, you see in the words of the Mekobalim, and in parentheses, who am I talking about? Be'etz Chaim of a Pardes. Etz Chaim and Pardes, two oifanim, two orders, which l'cha'ira are kemat hafchim, are opposite. L'cha'ira, they're mamash opposite. So when one reads Kabbalah, these Mekobalim, they come across two completely different methods of interpretation of how the Esses Riddus work. Who are the Eitz Chaim and the Pardes? The Eitz Chaim, chronologically, it's the Pardes and the Eitz Chaim. The Eitz Chaim was written by, it means the Tree of Life, of course, which was written by Reb Chaim Vital and encapsulates some of the fundamental teachings of his Rebbe, the Arizal. The Arizal, who was considered the greatest Kabbalist, or one of the greatest in the history of Yiddishkeit, who revolutionized the landscape of Pnimiyus HaTorah in 2 short years. Of course, lived in Tzfas. Many people visit his mikveh or his resting place in Tzfas. His yahrzeit is Hey Av Shin Lamed Beis, 1572, in the 5th of Av in the summer, where he lived in Tzfas the last years. You have the shul of the Arizal, the kever of the Arizal, the mikveh of the Arizal. And the Arizal his uniqueness of the Arizal is he's one of the few people who revealed so many new ideas and yet didn't have major opposition. It's a chiddush in Jewish history that somebody should reveal, should be so revolutionary in his teachings, and yet he had mamish very little opposition to Arizal. And he was accepted almost immediately by everybody, almost by everybody. To what degree is a question, but he was accepted by everybody, ad hayon. And the Arizal passed away very young, either 36 or 34 or 38. In 1572, the Arizal had a Rebbe, and his Rebbe was the Ramak, Reb Moshe Cordovero, who passed away just 2 years before him. Chav Gimel Tammuz, Shin Lamed, 1570. He's buried also there, Reb Moshe Cordovero. And he authored a sefer called Pardes, Pardes Rimoinim, The Orchard of Pomegranates, together with many other svarim. There's the famous Musa sefer of the Ramak. It's learned a lot. It's called Toimet Vayre. Ginas Egois, other svarim that he made. But his magnum opus is known as the Pardes, which is really an encyclopedic work. The Pardes Rimoinim tried to gather and compile all the teachings of Kabbalah that existed till his day, from Zohar, from Sefer Yetzirah, from Sefer HaBoyer, from all the writings of the Ramban and the other Mekobolim that existed till his day, and put it all together and organize it in chapters, in different topics, and reconcile contradictions. That was the Ramak. When the Ramak passed away, the Arizal started to teach in Tzfas. Ramak also lived in Tzfas. There was a Chabura. And then the Arizal started to teach the next 2 years. And the Arizal developed Kabbalah in a whole new way and systems much beyond the Ramak. So he says, when you study the Divrei HaKabbalah, whether they Chaim D'Arizal or the Pardes, Reb Moshe Cordovero the Ramak, you see two different, I find them two different methods. Ha'ofen Ha'alef, we're now going to read now and see the contradiction that he's raising. And as we said, it will become clearer and clearer. Ha'ofen Ha'alef, the first method is Shebchines Hishtalshalus Heimzeh Tachazeh. I'm going to have to concentrate a little better now. Me too. Shebchines ishtal shalusim zeh tachazeh. One is, they evolve one below the other. Zeh tachazeh, one below the other. The haynu. Shebchines bina netzla mebchines chachma. Bina emanates. Netzla comes from the word like Yevon Parshas Baal Oischa. Hashem says to the Moshe, choose 70 people. Ve'atzalti min haruach asher alecha. What does va'atzalti mean? I will take from the spirit on you and impart it to them. Right? I will emanate. In English, there's a word emanate. I will emanate from the ruach on you to them. Won't get taken away from you, like the Rashi brings from the Sifri kemadlik ner mineh, like lighting a candle from a big candle. First candle doesn't get diminished, but the light continues. So I'm going to take from the spirit on you and put it on the 70 people. That's what happens. That's the word va'atzalti. Netzla comes from that word. Netzla means it emanates from it. It emerges from it. B'chinas bina netzla b'chinas chachma. B'chinas das b'chinas bina. V'gimel elu hen gimel rishaynas. These are called gimel rishaynas, the three first ones. Chachma, which is the source for bina, and bina, which is the source for das. Ze tachaza. Umehem, and then from them, netzlu chagas. Chagas is chesed. Gvura Tiferes. You'll see Chabad is Chachma Bina Das. Chagas is Chesed. Gamkein also Alderech Hanal in the same fashion. Vihine, Siur Gashmi Halos. This physical picture, Hu Alderech Moshel Mipsari Echze. A metaphor for it would be, as we say, Mipsari Echze Lekah, the Pasuk says in Iyah, from my flesh I will perceive Hashem, which means there's a metaphor for it, there's a manifestation of it in the person. It's like the 10 faculties of the soul. The soul, the nefesh, is made up of 10 characteristics, 10 faculties. Again, chachma, bina, das, etc. And they're all manifested within the limbs of the body. The soul lives in the body. And different organs of the body are manifestations, are levushim, for different koiches of the soul. Chachma, bina, das are completely manifested, of course, in the brain. Everything is in the brain, but it's manifested, it's revealed through different parts, just like our power of vision, it's also in the brain, but it's manifested through the eye, and our power of smell, or our power of speech, or our power of motion, or our emotions, our feelings. Every koyach has the limb, the organ of the body that houses and manifest that koich. So that generally the 10 koiches ha-nefesh, from chachma through malchus, are manifested in the limbs of the body. Shereishis ha-gilui, the first revelation is always b'chachma. The faculty of chachma, shehi b'chines ha-vrakas ha-seichel b'chines nekudah. Chachma represents havrakas ha-seichel. The word havrakah comes from the word barak. Barak means a lightning. In Yiddish, a blitz. Havrakas ha-seichel. When the seichel enlightens the person, there's like a lightning flash, like a lightning goes off in the brain. B'chines nekudah. It's always a seminal point on nekudah. V'nikra chachma. That's why it's called chachma, which is a combination of two words. Koyach ma, which means the power of what. Ma means what. Like you say maza, right? Chacham mahu aymer, maza. Moshe says, v'nachnu ma, what are we? Who do you think we are that you're fighting us? Moshe says, v'nachnu ma, kisalinu alav, arid mahu, l'fi sh'adayin eina musegas. It's not a Rosh Hashanah. Very often when they write a Rosh Hashanah, When they write out a word in two, so it's like emphasis. Koyach ma, the koyach of ma. It's not a Rosh Hashanah. L'fisha adayin, it happens to me. Ma is also a gematria odom. Ma is one way how you write out yud kei vav kei, but that's not what he's getting into. L'fisha adayin ein musagas, because it's not yet comprehended. V'nikru b'chinas yud. This is also why chachma is also said with the yud, the first yud of yud kei vav kei, which is a nekuda. In the whole alphabet, aleph beis, the yud represents a point, a seminal point. The other letters are much more expansive. Umimenenim shechas b'chines bina. From chachma will come bina. Hispashtus ha-saga b'arich v'reichav. Where the comprehension will be expanded both in length and in breadth. V'hu b'chines hei. And this is the hei. The yud comes into the hei, which represents bina. Chachma and Bina are the father and the mother, which give birth to the midas, to the children. To the midas are usually called emotions or feelings. We'll see exactly what that means. Usually people translate midas as emotions and feelings. And as we will see, it's a pretty confusing translation because of what we call feelings is not exactly what midas are. But midas means the emotions that emerge from the chachma and bina, like the father and mother, which generally are ava v'yira, love and awe. Ki lefi sichlei v'izbeinu nusei b'davar, hu moilid ava l'davar o ayira m'menu. Because generally, all love or fear, ava or yira, are all based on understanding and awareness. Based on how I understand something, I think about something, I contemplate about something, that will be the father and mother that gives birth to my emotional relationship to it, whether through ava or yira, positive, closeness or rejection, a sense of love or a sense of reverence, of fear, of awe. So in the person, you have that same system. There's chachma, chachma gives rise to bina, and ultimately chachma bina give rise to ava and yira, etc. This is the system of zeh tachazeh, where one sphere, one kayach, emerges from the previous kayach as its progenitor, as its origin, as its source. That's what he says, mipsari echzeh, that this begins in the person himself. This is a mashal in the person himself. The 10 kayach is the way they're in the body. Different parts of the body manifest them, but it all begins with chachma, which is the first flash of consciousness, the first flash of seichel in the brain, and then gives birth to bina, etc. Ava and yira parallel chesed and gvura. In koiches hanefesh, chesed is represented by ava, kindness is connected to love, and gvura, discipline, or strength, is connected to yira, or, yeah, that's why he says ava and yira, and so forth. So, This is how it is in a person. But the reason it's in a person like this is because it's above like this. In Olam Atzilus, it's this way. We say that Ishtashlus Ayut Svidus. In the evolution of the ten Svidus, Pchinis Chachmei Lod Atzilus Ineshis Agilu. The Chachmei Lod Atzilus means the higher Chachma, which is Chachma of Atzilus, that's the beginning of the revelation. V'Pchinis Yud Shul Shem Avaya, that's the Yud. Sha'adayin Einim V'Pchinis Gilui. It's not yet revealed. V'Hachachma Mei Ayin Timotzeh. In Eov it says, where are you going to find Chachma? Chachma may ayin timotze. From where are you going to find it? But he's explaining it in the positive, that Chachma is the emergence from ayin. And therefore, it's less revealed, it's less begili, it's less yesh. That's why the Arizal says that Eirein Sov, the light of the infinite, is always manifested in Chachma, because it's reishis agili, there's still the ayin there. It's not so concrete and tangible. Umepchinas chachma nimshach pchinas bina datzilus. From chachma comes the next level, which is bina. Shupchinas giluya ispartus. Here there's already expansion. But oirich v'roichiv. It's called hey. Hey, the yud expands both in length and in breadth, both ways. V'nikra eim habonim. Another name for bina in the works of Kisvei Arizal is eim habonim smecha. The mother of the children. Chachma is the father, and bina is the mother. And we know the difference between the mother and the father when it comes to the fetus. The father contributes a seed, a sperm, a tippa. That seed has a lot in it. Microscopically, it contains the fetus. But the seed is mamish a tippa. It's a tiny little nekuda. Yet, when that nekuda is absorbed by the eim habanim, by the mother of the child, so together with her contribution with the egg, it develops into an embryo that then evolves into a full-fledged fetus over 9 months, and then a healthy, vibrant, living baby, Bezer Hashem, could be born. But without the mother, one remains with a seminal, literally seminal comes from that same word, semen, a sperm with a tippa, just a little drop which contains life in it. But it's still very, very concealed. It's in a state of potentiality. It has to be developed. That's why from Chachma, the Av, you come to Bina, which is Eima Banam, the mother. And so on and so forth. The father and the mother could then give birth to the children, Eim HaBanim Smecha, which would be Chesed, and then Gvura, and Tiferes, and Netzach, and Hoid, and Yesod, etc. All of the Midos that are born and emerge from the father and the mother. This is one system of the spheres. One system. Zeh Tachas Zeh. There's another way we see in Kabbalah, a completely different method. That the ten spheres are in a form of three kaven, which means three lines, like a triangle. Chachan bekav yamin. Chachma chesed netzach, and the right, chuli. Again, he assumes here previous knowledge, but this is a different system where it's not that the ten spheres, one follows the other, but rather there are units of three. So if you look at a picture, so to speak, a graph, there would be three completely different columns. On the right, on top, you'll have Chachma. On the left, you'll have Bina. One is not under the other. Chachma is on the right, Bina is on the left. They're on the same level. And in the middle, you'll have what's called Keser. Now you'll go down. Das is again in the middle, under Keser, right? Where is Chesed? Under Chachma. Gvura will be under Bina. Tiferes will be under Das. Netzach will go to the right. And then Hoid will go to the left. Yesod again will be under Tiferes, under Das, under Keser. And then Malchus is under that, separate. So you have on the right column, you'll have Chachan. Chachma, Chesed, and Netzach. On the left column, you'll have Bagar, Bina, Gvura, and Hoid. In the middle column, in the middle center column, you'll have Katad, you'll have Keser, Tiferes, and Das. So Zetachazah is Keser, under it, Chachma, Bina, Das, Chesed, Gvura, Tiferes, Netzach, like a straight line, one from the other. And then you'll have a completely different situation, where they're not coming one from the other, but there's like This, you have a picture. Okay, well, Weizen, give me, I'll show everybody. Where did you find this picture? Yeah, we're not going to count Kesser and Das together. This is a little picture. You can see this picture. I don't know how well you could see, huh? So on you'll have here, in the middle you'll have Kesser, right? On the right, Chachma. On the left, you'll have Bina. Under Chachma, you'll have Gedula, which is Chesed. On the left, you'll have Gevura. In the middle, you'll have Tiferes. And so it goes. Netzach right, Hoid left, Yisoid center. Everything is right, left, center. The first is the center, Kesser. Then Chachma is on the right, Bina on the left, like a triangle. Then you'll have a double triangle. You'll go the next level. And you'll have Chachma on the right, Bina on the left, and you'll have Das. And then you'll have Chesed on the right, Gvura and Tiferes, Netzach, Hoid, and then Yisoid, and under it Malchus. According to this, Chachma, Chesed, and Netzach are in the right column, Bina, Gvura, Hoid are in the left column, Keser, Das, Tiferes, and Yisoid are in the middle column. That's a completely different system of spheres in the Sifri HaKabbalah, and both are discussed, both are pictured. Adank. What do you want to ask?
Like a segel.
Like a segel, yeah. Like a segel, like a triangle, yeah. Yeah. Nimtzu lefi seder, according to this order, b'chinas chachma bin adas einim shachazu mizu. Chachma bin adas don't emerge from each other. V'gam ha-middas kulon, einikram shachasam ha-gimul rishaynas. Also the middas, they don't emerge, like we said before, from the first three chachma bin adas. Me'achad shachachma bin ha-imdas b'beis kavin makbilos. Because chachma and bin are standing in two parallel lines. So which depends which middah. Chesed is associated with Chachma. Gvura is a completely other side. You're not going to say that the middahs just come from Chachma, Bina, Das, like we said earlier. Chabad doesn't come from each other. Chachma's on the right, Bina's on the left. They're not under each other, right? And the middahs also are not under Chabad. One middah is associated with one, another middah is associated with something else. V'hine ikra hefer shemebez ha-pchines b'seder ishtal shlusanal u'bebez efanah. The main difference between the two systems expressed in two areas. Ha'alef, area number one is, Lefi Seder Ha'alef, in the first system, Chabad Hemzu Tachazu. Chachma bin Adas are one below the other. Nimtze, Sha'adas Oymed Lamata Mechachma Bina. Which means Das is always under Chachma and Bina. Chachma, then Bina, then Das, under it. Like a hierarchy. Ulamayla Mechesed Gvura. And Das is always higher than Chesed and Gvura. Chachma bin Adas are above. Das comes from after Chachma and Bina, and higher than Chesed and Gvura. Ki hu amam shecha ares ha-chachmu bina le-chesed and Gvura. Das is actually the channel from Chachma and Bina to Chesed and Gvura. Das is the link from Tati and Mami to the Kinderlach, to the children. Mashenkel if he said rabbeis, but in the second system, Shem begimel kaven, where the spheres are not in one line, but in three separate columns, like triangles, nimtza, shadasu bekavem tzoi. Das is in the middle column. Das doesn't stand under Chachma bin Arak, Tachas HaKesser. Das is directly related to Kesser, which is the crown above all. And in fact, here Das becomes the channel from Kesser to the Chachma on the right, to the Bina on the left, and then to Chesser and Gvura in the next column of right and left, as we will explain. So one major difference is the place of Das. In the first system, Das is below Chachma and Bina, and it's the intermediary between Chachma and Bina and the Midas, which are under Das. That's system number one. In system number two, it's a completely different hierarchy. Keser, which is on the top, feeds directly into Das, which is the middle. Chachma is on the right, Bina is on the left. Das is not accepting and receiving of Chachma and Bina. Das has a channel to Keser. And it channels Kesser. In fact, it's the channel of Kesser. And then gives it to the right and to the left, if anything. And then to Chesed and Gvura, because it's the middle. And the middle becomes, like the middle means it's the center. It's the center point. It's the core. It's the vortex. It's the emtsa. It's the merkaz.
So why don't we do that? Kesser goes down to Chachma and Bina and goes,
Chachma and Bina is parallel to Kesser or parallel to Das?
Kesser is on top.
Right.
Kesser is on top, beyond Chachma and Bina. Right? And then you have on the right Chachma, on the left Bina, and then Das in the middle. So Das is channeling Kesser. because Das is the same column like Keser. Unlike in the first system, where Chachma and Bina are above Das, and Das channels Chachma and Bina to the next level. Here, Das is directly channeling Keser. Das is Makabel from Keser, not from Chachma and Bina. That's system number two.
Why does it flow that way? Why can't it flow in any direction?
Then after you say from Das,
well, the reason we say Das is in the center is for that reason. Why is Das and Keser in the center? Because there's a relationship between them that is unique.
Why can't
the picture is simply a muscle. It's not about a picture.
No, if everything's together, that doesn't have
not to together. Why is Keser in the middle and Das in the middle, and not Das on the right or on the left? Because Das is uniquely has an intimate connection to Keser versus Chachma and Bina. Keser is channeled through Das. That's why it's in the middle. The fact that it's in the middle is just a way of saying that Das is channeling Keser, rather than Das is channeling Chachma and Bina to the next place. You understand what I'm saying?
Isn't it a segel that Das is lower than Chachma and Bina?
That's why his picture was confusing. That's why his picture was confusing. So just for the sake of clarity, keep it not like a segel. Keep Chachma on the right, Bina on the left, Das in the middle, under Keser. Okay? Or Chachma and Bina, instead of doing a segel, do it like a triangle. I said a triangle, not a segel. That's why I said a triangle. You understand what I'm saying? Das in the center and Chachma and Bina on the right and on the left. And then you'll have Tiferes and Chesed and Gvura. And then you'll have Yesoid and Netzach and Hoid. Okay? So that's the second way. V'habeiz is one more difference. L'fisei dira aleph in the first system, ikirei lados umetzias amidus umichachmo binai de adas amamshuch kamal. The midis come from chachma and bina through das. Mashenki l'fisei dira beiz, heinim shachas b'pchinas hakesedai de adas amamshuch b'anaris hakesed afka. Where in the second oifen, the midis don't come through chachma and bina, not necessarily. Actually, the midis are channeled from keser through Das, who introduces to them the light of Keser. So two major differences. Difference number one is in Das. Difference number two is in all the Middas. In system number one, Das is below Chachma and Bina, and it's the intermediary between Chachma and Bina and all of the Middas. Where in system number two, that hierarchy completely breaks down. It does not exist anymore. Because Das is not under Chachma and Bina, on the contrary. Das is directly under Keser, which means its relationship is with Keser. And as we will see, it feeds Chachma and Bina, Keser and Gvura. That's a difference in Das. But it also results in a major difference in terms of the Middos. In the first system, all the Middos are children of Chachma and Bina and Das. That's where they emerge. In the second system, it's a whole different idea. Take Tiferes. Tiferes is not born from Gvura and Chesed. Tiferes is born from where? Tiferes is directly under Das, which is directly under Keser. The Middos are channeled in a completely different way. It's not that the Middos come from Chachma and Bina. No. The Middos are channeled through Das, which comes from Keser. And Das feeds Chesed. Das feeds Gvura, right? Tiferes will feed Netzach. Das feeds Chachma. Das feeds Bina. Tiferes will feed Chesed and Gvura. Yesoid will feed Netzach and Hoid. All from the middle, which is Das through Keser, a whole different system.
Does Keser feed also Chachma and Bina?
Through Das. Through Das. The columns are very, very meticulous. The columns represent how it gets channeled. You channel through your column, right? So Chesed will feed Netzach, and Chachma will feed Chesed. But the middle column is a direct contact. So Keser feeds Das, since Keser is always on the top. So here, Das, suddenly, the hierarchy has changed. Instead of Das being under Chachma and Bina, Das is in a completely different place, and therefore all the Middos are affected. Because now the Middos receive from Das, which receives from Keser. So it's a whole different, even Chachma and Bina. I mean, even Chesed and Gvura. It's all connected to Das, because Das feeds Keser into all of them. So it's a completely different system. Where in the first system, Keser, Chachma, Chachma, Bina, Bina, Das, Das, Chesed, Gvura, Tiferes, Netzach, and Yesed, Malchus.
In the second system, Chachma and Bina are not Alpha and Bina.
So in the second system, it's not so simple to call Chachma and Bina father and mother. I'm not going to say not, but it's not so pashut. The role of father and mother, there is a very different role. Right?
Why can't they be father and mother for Chesed and Gevurah?
Yes, that's what I'm saying. It's not that they're not Ava'im anymore, but it's a completely different understanding.
How do we integrate the two systems? How do we consider them in relation to each other?
Well, at this point, we don't consider them in relation to each other. Before relationships, they first have to have their own identity.
Okay.
So first they have to have their own identity, then they can be a relationship. So when somebody sees this, there's a contradiction here. It's a completely different system. Okay, there's two systems. And then you can go better and ask the important question of two words, L'mayin afkimin, who cares? Fine, you put Das here, put Kesa here. As far as I'm concerned, you can put another few people in between. Put them in the right column, the middle column, the left column. So this is where it's important to understand here that all these pictures are just descriptions of intangible words, of profound ideas of how the system of life, of how this whole system of life works. As we shall see in the Hemshech of the Maimer, that these two systems are completely two different systems of understanding the entire human structure as well. As we see here, it's all paralleled in the human structure. Completely two different sets of ways of understanding the entire system of a person's life, how our lives develop, both in terms of our will, our intellect, and our relationships, our emotions. And it's always how Das plays, how Das comes out, as we will continue learning in the Hemshech of the Maimer. Again, I know that this is somewhat abstract or extremely abstract and intricate. So I do request from you to stay the course. You could chazer it, learn it well, pasha to get the facts of what he's saying, and then we'll go on, Be'ezer Hashem, the next days to develop it further. So brief summation, the Nekudas HaTamtzis that we learned was that in Sifrei HaKabbalah, in the works of the Kabbalah in Eitz Chaim and in Pardes, one finds two systems which apparently seem almost paradoxical. In the words of the Baal HaTanya, L'chayre him kim'at hofchim. Apparently they seem almost completely opposite. System number one is what he calls Zeh Tachazeh. Seder Hishtalshalus Zeh Tachazeh. That when we speak about the 10 koiches, the 10 faculties of the soul, which originate in the 10 kivayochel, in the 10 spheres, in the 10 faculties or 10 characteristics through which Hashem manifests himself, one evolves and emerges from the other. So you'll have chachma, and below that, below, we don't mean in space, we're not talking about graphic. We're not talking about space. Below, we mean in concept, following from it, emerging from it. That's what below means. You'll have Bina and Das will become the channel, the intermediary between Chachma and Bina, and then the next level, which are the Midas, Chesed, Gvura, and then Tiferes, all the way down, Netzach, Chayit, Yisod, and Malchus, which gives us the number 10. That's one system called Zeh, Tachazeh. One below, one emerging from the other. Chachma, Bina, Das would be called Gimel Rishonis, the three first, meaning the first three spheres. The next seven would be called Zayin Tov, Zayin Tachtonis, the seven lower ones. Just like in the person, he said, one begins with Chachma, which is a flash of inspiration, a flash of intelligence, a flash of wisdom, like a lightning. It's pitch dark and a lightning strikes, and for a moment there is an extraordinary brightness and luminescence, which then disappears. And then comes Bina, which is the development of the idea. As he says, from Yud you go to Hey. The Yud is the point and the Hey is the expansion. From father you go to mother. The father provides the seed and the mother absorbs it, fertilizes it, develops it. Because she fertilizes it, she can then develop it into a full-fledged baby that's Av is the father, is a symbol for Chachma. Abe is the mother, is a symbol for Bina. And then the mother gives birth. From the father and the mother, from this process is birth. The birth is the birth, what we call the Midos. Ahava, love, Yira, awe, and all of the other emotions and experiences. And this is a reflection of how it is, Kivayachal, by Hashem, in what he calls the world of Atzilus, the first world, the divine world. We also have this process of Yud, which is the beginning of the Gili, which is Chachma, Chachma Me'ayin Timotze, and then from there you go to Bina, which is the Eim HaBonim, and then Vav and Hey. The other system, however, is very different. The other system, he says, is not Zeh Tachazeh, it's rather what he calls a Tziur of Gimel Kavim, right? Tziur of Gimel Kavim would mean that there are three columns, not one below the other, but one parallel to the other. Not the hierarchy, but the picture would be a different picture. The form would be a different form. Again, we're not talking in space. We use the word pictures just to illustrate a concept. It's to illustrate an idea which is abstract. So that's why we use forms and pictures simply to make it a little more accessible. And here, Chachma Bina Das don't flow from each other, but they parallel each other. Nor do the Midas flow from the Gimel Rishonis, Chachma, Bina, Das. Again, they parallel each other. In fact, what you have is three columns. On top, in the middle, you'll have Keser. On the right, you'll have Chachma. On the left, you're going to have Bina. And this will continue in every process. So on top, all the way on top, you'll have Keser. Then you'll have on the right, Chachma. On the left, Bina, and in the middle, you're going to have the column of Keser, which is on top, and Das. Das is in the middle. And then it will continue in every one, every three. Keser on the right, under Chachma, Gvura on the left, under Bina. Tiferes in the middle, under Das, under Keser. Netzach on the right, under Chesed, Hoid on the left, under Gvura, and then Yisoid again in the middle column. Malchus is just like Keser is above, Malchus is below. That's why he says it's always the picture of Chachan. Chachan is an acronym of Chachma, Chesed, Netzach, because they are all right column spheres. The other one would be Baga, which is Bina Gvura Hoid, which is left column spheres. The middle would be Keser on top, Das, Dos Dati, Das, Tiferes, and Yisoid.
Keser is a
Makoni Tadwell? Keser is the crown, so Keser is above Chachma. Keser means the crown, which is above Chachma. Just like the crown is on top of the head. So spiritually speaking, in the spheres, Keser is above Chachma. Chachma is in the brain. It's the first experience of the conscious mind, is Chachma. The flash, you know, a person has a dilemma, you're confused, and then suddenly you have this, I got it. The aha moment, we call it inspiration. That's called Chachma. There's a conscious thought, some experience. Something comes into your brain, an idea, an answer, a solution, an awareness. Something opens up. That's Chachma. But then you got to develop it. That's Bina. The father comes to the mother. That's Bina. And then there's Das, Keser. But Keser is the crown, which is above Chachma, like the crown physically, which is above the king's head. It lay upon top of his head and represents something higher than Chachma. As we will see, it's connected to Ratz and will. Verstehst?
Yesterday was said that there's Chachma in his ass, then seven spheres, right?
Seven midas.
Seven midas. So that's the ten.
Yeah. You want to know how did 11 come in?
No, that's without Keser.
Without Keser, it's 10. With Keser, it's 11. You want to know how that works? It's 10 or 11. Keser is often not counted because it's above. It's number 11, it's above. There are systems, we will see, in which Keser is counted and then Das is not counted.
Isn't it the source?
Right, so according to that, Keser, Das is not counted, and then it's Chochmah Gvura,
and then Chesed Gvura. There are such situations where Keser is counted and Das is not counted.
Keser is good, it's not possible.
Yeah. What are the two? There's two major differences between these two systems, Pashut, to understand the mathematics of it, or the facts of it, I should say. The first is that in the first system, Chachma, Bina, Das are one below the other. So Das is under Chachma and Bina and emerges from them, receives from them, and then gives to what is below it, which is Chesed and Gvura, and Tiferes, etc. So it's above Chesed and Gvura, it's below Chachma Bina, that's the first system. Where in the second system, that's not the case, Das is not under Chachma and Bina. In fact, Das is in the middle, the center. And where does it receive from? It receives them directly from Keser, which is on top of the spheres, which is in the middle. So it's a whole different Das. This is not a Das that channels Chachma and Bina. This is a Das that emerges from Keser Kavem Tzai. And it's the other way around. It channels Keser. Because it's in the middle column, it gives to Chachma and Bina, rather than it takes from Chachma and Bina and gives to Chesed and Gvura. That's a whole different picture. That's why it says it's almost contradictory. Who is this Das character? The second major difference is not on Das, but the second major difference is on the Midas. In the first system, the Midas come from where? From Chachma and Bina, the father and the mother. Again, through Das, because Das is under Chachma and Bina. That's in the first system. In the second system, the Midas have access not necessarily to Chachma and Bina. True. There are the Midas of the right column. There are the Midas of the left column. There's also the Midas in the middle column. The Midas in the middle column have no connection to Chachma and Bina. Right? They take Midas HaTiferes, emerges from the middle column, which is from Das, which is from Keser. So that means you have a relationship between Midas and Keser and Das that is not through the medium of Chachma and Bina, like in the first case, where all the Midas emerge after Chachma and Bina because there's a clear hierarchy and you're not escaping that hierarchy. But here, in the second one, it's a completely different system where the Midas can be accessed through Das, which channels Keser and the Kav Emtzai. So therefore, when you look at these facts in the works of Kabbalah, this seems like a contradiction. Who is Das and who are the Midas? I will say, obviously, the obvious. Most people, would, even if they see the contradiction, it's like, okay, what else is on the menu today? What's for breakfast? But somebody who understands that the system of Pnimiyus HaTorah, the system of Torah HaKabbalah, is not just words. It's actually the spiritual science of the entire universe. It's the spiritual science of the universe. That's what Kabbalah is. It's the spiritual science of the soul. Just like biology is the physical science of the soul, and science and physics is our attempt to understand the physics of the universe, much of Kabbalah, of Pnimiyus HaTorah, is the science of the universe, the spiritual science of the universe, and the spiritual science of the soul, which is, of course, the spiritual origin of the physical science of the soul and of the universe. And it's not only of the universe and of the soul, but it's really, the, so to speak, the setup, the system that the Ribbono Shel Olam set up. Even Kivayach within himself, Nasa Adam Betzalmeinu Kidmuseinu, and we're making a person in our image, as the Pasuk says in Bereishis. So these types of contradictions, for a mind like the Balatanya, were alarming. So now he continues. And on the top line of Daf Yutes Amud Beis, page 37, V'ha'inyin hu d'shneim emes. You could have guessed that, probably. The inyin is that both charts, both systems, are emes, are true. V'yuvon zeh, this will be understood al pimashen noida, based on what is known. Known means known to those who know. Sheyesh beis p'chines das. When we speak of Das, we have to differentiate between two types. Das Elyon and Das Tacht. The higher Das and the lower Das. Das HaElyon, the higher Das, who are Nimshuch B'chines HaKeser. That is the Das that flows. It emerges from Keser. U'mechaber u'meyached l'chachmo bina. And then we'll synthesize Chachmo bina. That's what a center, you'll say a centrist person, could synthesize the right winger and the left winger, right? He can bring them together. I don't mean to get political here, but everything originates in spirituality. You have right wingers, you have left wingers, and you have centered. So you have centered people who are in the center because they don't like to take positions. That would be like the Kotzker Rebbe said, as the Einzige was gaten mitten weg, is a ferd. Menschen gehen other rechts, other links. Kotzker Rebbe said, there were no highways then, but in the roads, the horse is the only one who manages to stay in the center. People are either to the right, they walk to the right or to the left, which was, of course, his explicit and blunt way of describing his position about people who play it safe and are always sitting on the fence. They're good with everybody because they're good with nobody but themselves, and they just protect it. That's one type of center. But there's a different type of center. The Rambam says in Hilchos Deis that the path of life should be the Derech Emtzayis, not the extreme life. That's what we're talking here, center. The center is not because the person is afraid to take a position, but because the person has the maturity to be able to see different positions and perspectives and then try to bring out the best in each and bring them together. Das, as we will see, is the center. The center is the one that can synthesize right and left, which makes it centered. It's in the middle. It's not right. It's not left. So Das always connects. In the Das Elyon, he receives some Keser in the middle column, and he brings together Chachma and Bina. He impacts Chachma and Bina. He's Mechaber u'meyachet. Links and unites, unifies, which is even deeper than Chibur. Al Yidei Ha'aras HaKeser, by introducing Keser.
The Das... Is influencing, or is it just sovel?
Synthesizing. Synthesizing.
It's not just sovel, the two ends.
You're right, yeah. Synthesizing, actually impact. V'das, v'das ha-tacht, and then there's the lower das, who ha-das ha-mispashet b'toy ha-middas. This is the das that extends within the middas, la-hamshech behena ares chachma bina, to bring into the middas, again, connecting chachma and bina together, and bringing in chachma and bina into the middas. So there's two dasas. There's the das Elyon, that's the das that's channeling Keser, and that das actually synthesizes Chachma and Bina. It's like above Chachma and Bina. And then there's the das Tachten, that's the first system, right, which is below Chachma and Bina and brings Chachma and Bina into the Middas. Just like there's two types of das, there's two types of Middas. Ha'alev, Middas, Sheker, Mitzius, and Chachma and Bina. The first is the midas that their main reality emerges from Chachma Bina al derech Moshe b'adam lamat. The metaphor would be a person below shamidas hein rak lefi asechel, where one's midas, one's emotions are always based on his or her mindset, awareness. Shahasechel hu amelidon, because seichel is what gives birth to these midas. V'katan shasichlei katzer chuli. He doesn't finish the sentence. An immature, a child who has a certain awareness of things, his emotional responses will be reflective of that type of awareness. Basically, our midos, our emotional responses, are always a reflection of our awareness. There's no such a thing as an emotion, l'chaira, at this moment, in this context of midos. Every emotion is preceded by awareness, a certain awareness. It's hard for us to see sometimes. It's hard when you're feeling an emotion to say, wait, who is the mother of this emotion? Who is the father? Emotions are so intense. A person is so intense, it consumes you. But really, if you stop and you go back, there's a perception that gives birth to the emotion. There's always a perception that gives birth to the emotion. It just happens so fast, and it's sometimes so ingrained that we don't feel we have control over it. But every Mida is a child, and every child came about through somebody. Somebody's responsible for this child. They may not take responsibility. Child may be too rowdy. They want to give him up for adoption. That's what people do with their emotions. They don't want to take responsibility for their children. But you got to take responsibility for your children. And the worst thing is to be afraid of your children. Not good. Not good. Yes, they can be scary. They could be scary, but they come from you. That means all the fear of your children is something inside of you, because they come from you. There's nothing in the child that ultimately you can't confront, you can't deal with it. So you see this constantly with people and their emotions. They're frightened of their emotions like they're frightened of their teenage children. And they say, when did you ever come into my family? I can't have to do with you. So when it comes to adoption, it's a little bit of a more dramatic amputation. But emotionally, people do it all the time. I don't own these emotions. They're not mine. Nish meine Kinder. Hey, you can have them. You can raise them. I'll send you $100 a month. Raise them.
that the emotions are according to a person's intellect. That's nothing to do with seichel, that's to do with maturity, you know? Because you can have a very smart person who is very mature.
Of course, yeah. It has to do with seichel, with perception, with awareness, and with maturity. With maturity is a major development of seichel. A mature seichel is a different type of seichel. It's a seichel with experience. It's a seichel that is realistic. You can have a 7-year-old genius, you know, who knows the dictionary, but he's still a child. And as we will see, this is where Das plays a major role. This is where Das, which is partly maturity, it's all other things too, plays a major role. It's not just the father and the mother and the children. Chachma is the father, Bina is the mother, but there's Das in the middle of it. Where does Das come in? From a mother, you have a child. But we know a mother has to be developed to be able to have a child. Biologically, it has to be a certain state to be able to have a child. The same is true spiritually and emotionally. So that's why a katan has different middos. A gadol has different middos. Some people remain katanim their whole life.
And still they can have kids that have Das.
Yes. Yeah.
So that's
and hopefully they'll grow up one day through that.
Parents.
Yeah, or the other way, so the parents grow up through their children. Their children make them aware that they're parents. Yeah. I was once speaking in a shul, and there was a problem with the men realizing that they grew up. They had a problem with it. I was once speaking at a shul, I was invited to a bar mitzvah, and I knew it was a shul that the parents still refused to acknowledge that they grew up, which is an understandable emotion. It's always easier to see yourself as a 9-year-old, and you could just run for the lollipops. So basically, when the lollipops came, the adults were ahead of the children. You know, sometimes when you see they have a children's dinner and the ones who are there are the adults, because it's real food. It's French fries, chicken nuggets, hamburgers. It's not the fake, veal and fancy spare ribs. That's $80 a plate. This is the basics, $3, but that which sustains civilization. So I told him that one of the Aseres Hadibros is Kabed Asavicha Vesimecha. Respect your father and mother. So it doesn't only mean respect your father, obviously means respect your father and mother. It also means Kabed Asavicha, respect your fatherhood. Respect the office. Respect yourself as a father. Respect yourself as a mother. See who you are. I know you feel like a 14-year-old immature teenager trying to figure himself out, still trying to have fun at night. I got it. We have to make space for that too. That's also your child. We don't have to give him up. But respect your fatherhood. Respect yourself as a father. You're not 2 years old, you're a father. So you say, ich kenn nicht, ich weiß nicht, I don't. Fine. So maybe we have to learn a few things, but a person has to realize that. And that challenges me to rise to the occasion, notwithstanding the fact that this still unresolved stuff, and in many ways I'm still a child. And in many ways that's also a good thing that you're still a child, because there's a certain spontaneity and immaturity and inquisitiveness maybe and curiosity, and you still like to play with the trucks and with Lego and so forth. So on this level, which will be developed more, but the first basic idea is that all middos, an emotion, is always born from a perception. Which means, on level one, when you're feeling, let's be very practical, when a person is feeling a very negative feeling towards somebody, you're feeling hate, you're feeling terrible frustration, you're feeling alienation, whether it's sadness, anger is a big one. Anger, you're angry. All the emotion says is, I'm angry. This person is the worst person. Why did I ever get involved with this person? Frustration, whatever the emotion is. And that's what it is. That's what you're feeling. That's what it is at that moment. And sometimes you could feel it all over the place and it just paralyzes you. There's nothing else you can do. You stop thinking about it. You push it out and it comes back with a vengeance. And one thing a person has to know, it's not the only thing, but one thing a person has to know is there is an entire set of beliefs that preceded that emotion. This kid was not born in a vacuum. An emotion is a child. A child doesn't just pop out one day. Even a penguin and any bird and any mammal and any fish, it's a process. Birth is a process. It doesn't happen azoy. It's a process, and it's a long process. Sometimes it's a process of years, sometimes it's a process of 9 months, depends on every creature. Kol chad v'chad l'fum shayura delay. But it's a process. In other words, there's an entire set of beliefs, of ideas, of perceptions, of thoughts, of machshavas, of awareness, of perspectives and perceptions that are the father and mother of this emotion. And when I can challenge those perceptions, when I can go back to those perceptions, quite interestingly, a lot of my emotional attitudes and experiences will be seriously refined or altered or developed. Why? Because somebody is responsible for these children. And if I can go back to that one who is responsible, a lot of things can change. So as we said, the worst thing a person could do with children is, I don't own you, I can't deal with you, you're too much for me. Never do that, never do that. You may feel that it's too much, that I understand. But feeling that it's too much, that itself comes from a perception. Feeling that it's too much is also information I feed myself. And that's a big question. What is the information you've fed yourself or has been fed to you over many years? Sometimes a person is 40 or 45 or 55. It's hard for them to go back and see who are the fathers and mothers of all these kids. Because 30, 40 years, you're trained to think of this way about yourself. This is your belief system. This is your seichel. These are your machshavas. It's already taken for granted now. It's a given. And now you're just responding. And every day it's the same response. You're simply living out this script. Or as some like to say, what are the stories you tell yourself? What are the stories you have told yourself? What are the stories that are ingrained in your psyche and character about who you are, about who other people are? And the more a person takes responsibility for this, the more a person can take responsibility for their children, the better off their children will be. You don't do your children a favor by being scared of them, by disowning them. No, go in there. Face it. Look at it. There's nothing you can't deal with. This is yours. This is yours. Of course, the metaphor is not completely perfect because when your child is 50 years old or your child is 25 years old, that's not inside of you. But the metaphor is an important metaphor. You don't amputate. You don't cut off. I'm scared to talk to you. I don't know who you are. This is too hard for me. That's what people do with their own emotions all the time. So what happens? Doesn't go away. Doesn't go away. It's just completely not dealt with. Nothing goes away. It's there. It's just not dealt with. So it comes back with more mishugasan and sometimes more strength and makes you more mishugah, more miserable. Verstandig? But this is a maturity. This is a depth. This is a responsibility. The person has to be able to see this process. And it's also true in education. A lot of times people see things that are happening with their children at home. Very often all the children are doing is they're playing out what's happening between the husband and the father. Yeah. Good Freudian slip. At least in my case, maybe. But all very often with playing up between the husband and the wife, the father and the mother. It's the av and the aim. It's not easy to go there. It's much easier to say ADD, ADHD, PDD, mishugah, incapable, chavezavos, which fine, there may be issues and challenges you have to deal with in terms of the child, but very often the place to go back is to the source. They're just playing out. They're just playing out emotions that you're not dealing with, emotions that you're repressing, relationship challenges that have been dismissed and have been buried, and kids who are very sensitive just play it out. It's something they play it out in a very aggressive way. These kids are not crazy. These kids are actually very normal, and they can't deal with the dysfunction, and this is their best, most respectful way of expressing the dysfunction. They're actually doing very well for the situation. Because if they would really be blunt, they should tell their mother and father the truth. They don't. They have rachmanis on them. They may not even know it themselves. So that's one dimension that we always have to understand, the relationship between midas and the perceptions that give rise to them. Which means I never, ever get angry at anybody. I don't mean I mean you. You, Nochem, yeah. You never, ever, no one, none of you, ever get angry at anybody. Ever, ever. So you'll tell me, please, why don't you follow me throughout the day? But it's the truth. It's the truth. There's nothing anybody can tell you that will trigger your anger or other emotions. It's always your thoughts about what they told you that trigger your emotions. Of course, I know it's what they told you that trigger your emotions, but it's not what they told you. V'haraya, they told me the same thing. They told him the same thing. We responded in opposite ways. Why? You say we have different personalities, but what does that mean, we have different personalities? It means it's not what you said that triggered the emotion. It's my thoughts about what you said that triggered the emotion. But that step, I skip, because it's the father and the mother. But a child has a father and a mother. You have to respect the father and mother. First thing you respect is, why do you have to respect them? Because they take responsibility. There's a reason we respect our father and mother. Because under natural circumstances, the right thing might have been for them to kill us. Right? A mother of a teenage children said she now understands the animals that kill their children. In a humorous way, of course. And yet fathers and mothers take care of their children, hopefully. Again, we're talking about functional parents, healthy parents, normal parents. And even if they're not completely functional, completely healthy, but very often they try to do the best they can with the tools that they have and with the lack of awareness and perception that they have. Now, sometimes people are in a prison because their whole life, they're feeling stuff, they're experiencing stuff, and they never once stopped and said, who gave birth to these emotions? The emotions become God. They can't be challenged. They don't have a father and mother. The only thing that doesn't have a father and mother in this world is the Ribbono Shel Olam. And your emotions are important, but they're not God. So it's a fascinating thing. When emotions become worshipped as God, we actually could never liberate ourselves from it. When emotions can be respected as children, not as gods, they can grow up, they can develop. So I don't have to run from them, but I don't have to worship them. Worshipping them is the opposite mistake, where there's nothing but them. It's like worshipping a 4-year-old child and his attitudes, or worshipping a 12-year-old and her attitudes. You don't worship these attitudes. Do you respect it? You respect it in the sense that you have to create space for it. You have to see what's going on. You can't make believe it doesn't exist. Respect doesn't always mean you agree with something. Respect means if somebody is in my office and he may have a certain hang-up, I have to respect what is going on and see the process. If I make believe it doesn't exist, then I'll never be dealt with. It'll just get worse. If I worship it, then I become a complete victim to it. The proper approach is always like a child. You never disown a child. You never make believe the child is not crying. The child doesn't have an attitude. But I don't have to take it seriously to the point that this is divine. This I have to worship. Same is true with your emotion. Give it space. And then in a curious, calm, non-judgmental fashion, be curious as to who are the fathers and mothers of these emotions. And you will see that a lot of your life will change from that. You will be opened up to reality. And I say non-judgmental because that's another quality with children. You don't judge your child. You have a 9-year-old kid who's throwing a tantrum, or a 7-year-old who's throwing a tantrum, or a 4-year-old. You don't start judging them. You're such a baby. You're such a baby. Imagine you tell your 3-year-old, people do it and it's a terrible mistake. You're such a baby. Cry baby. Cry baby. Cry baby. Of course, that's what 2-year-olds are supposed to be. You're also cry baby. You just do it without tears, but you're the same crybaby. You just get angry at the world. You're frustrated at everybody. You hate everybody. You're not a crybaby. You're a 72-year-old crybaby. Or a 46-year-old crybaby. You're not a crybaby. You just cry over bigger toys than smaller toys. Somebody took away his horse and Evet Meshuggah. And somebody takes the last piece of sushi at the Kiddush. What do you do? For a month you hate this guy. You're much worse than your child. Your child is a horse. Your last piece of sushi at the kiddush, you were eyeing it for 5 minutes. It's a competition between you and the other guy, and he got it. And forget it. Chassal said the Pesach. That relationship is dead. Usually when we have to call other people, everybody relates to this, yeah? There's always the last piece of sushi. You know that piece of sushi? It's for hacked, it's for foiled, it's for shimmeled, it's there for 4 days. But for hungry Jews after Musaf, it's Mamash Yimaisa Mashiach. And the truth is, the more I don't respect the crybaby in me, the more I have to scream at the crybaby in my child. I don't have space for it in myself, so I have to. So the way I deal with it with myself is I don't recognize it. So when I see it in you, it drives me crazy because it triggers my own. So I have to knock it down. But you don't judge a child. You don't worship a child, but you don't judge a child. And you don't disown it. You realize this is the child, and this is the process of growing up. And you look at what the reality is, and you embrace it on one level. You let it be, but you realize that it has a father and a mother. In other words, it's not unchangeable. It's not immutable. It's not divine. The only one who doesn't have a father and mother is Hashem. And Adam and Chava, I guess, they didn't have a biological father and mother, but they were still created from a source.
So when we see the chesed in someone else, that's really the chesed in me.
That's why the Baal Shem Tov said that another person is a mirror. Another person is a mirror, which means what I see in you is very often a reflection of what I see in myself.
I don't want to see myself.
Or what I don't want to see in myself. Very often you're triggering within me things that I don't want to deal with. And when I see them in you, they drive me crazy. It's not you're driving me crazy. It's me driving me crazy. But I don't know that I'm driving me crazy. You help me bring out that I'm driving myself crazy. So instead of getting upset at you, I should say, well, thank you for being a mirror. Which is always a wonderful experience in life. Sometimes you see your children behaving a certain way. Look up, take a deep breath and say, thank you for being a mirror. Thank you for being a mirror.
But who is really the father and mother in such things?
Who is really the father and mother?
Meaning,
I don't know. I'm not a prophet. I don't know. All I'm saying is we have to have the courage to be able to see the father and the mother. There are thoughts that I am experiencing. There are perceptions. There are belief systems that I've been set in my place, right? And that's how I process what you're telling me. And it's happening every single day. And not surprisingly, the children are products of that. I'm talking about spiritual children, are products of that. So I have to be able to come and say, what is my thought process? In marriage, this is one of the biggest issues. People are married. Over the first few years, they develop certain emunos, I would call them, beliefs about their spouse. Sometimes emunas tefelis, but if they would know it's emunas tefelis, sometimes they think that is emuna. They're emuna about their spouse. They equate with emuna and God. Again, they don't think there's parents. Nobody owns these emotions. These emotions are absolute truths, like anoichi Hashem alekecha. Now what happens is 5, 10, 15, 20 years later, whatever it is, these are not up for negotiation. I know who my husband is. I know who my spouse is. It's not even a shaila. You don't even go there. This is the yisoida yisoidas. These are the premises and the paradigms by which you play your game of chess. Everything else follows that. So now there's a bunch of children running all over the house, terrorizing the house. Smoke bombs every night. Wildfires. Arson. Terrorism in the house. I'm talking about your heart. The heart. The house here is a muscle for your heart. The kids are actually playing it out too, but we're not now talking about the actual kids. We're talking about the kids inside of you, the playground inside of you. And it's a given. Oh, she did this again. He did this again. He said this. She said this. He came home late. She came home late. This was not ready. But it's not really what he said. It's not what she said. It's not what he did. It's not what she did. It's how you thought about what she said and what she did and what he said and what he did. But those thoughts are already buried in the foundation of my soul. I don't want to go back there. That's the point, that take responsibility for your children. Take responsibility for your emotions and realize that they come from somewhere. They don't exist in a vacuum. You don't have to judge them. Don't amputate them. Don't disown them and don't be afraid of them. Never be afraid of your child. Never. the worst thing for your child. Children don't need parents to be afraid of them. Children need parents to be there with them in their fear. The more you're afraid of your child, the more your child is afraid of himself. Parents think they do a service by detaching. Let him grow up himself. No, he doesn't have to grow up himself. He needs a father to be there with him, to give him his space, to let him become a person. He's not an extension of your fantasies and hallucinations and expectations. That's another issue. We're not going there right now. Baruch Hashem, there's a lot of stuff to talk about when it comes to these issues. But the more you work on yourself, the more you have hope to be able to inspire those around you, to be able to be the people who are they're capable of becoming. Right? So therefore, your child doesn't need you to fear him, to fear her. I can't deal with you. No. They fear themselves much more. They're responding to their own stuff. You got to be there. You have to know how to be there, obviously with seichel. But you have to be emotionally present in the lives of your children. The biggest mistake today that parents make is that they're not emotionally present in the lives of their children. They detach because it's hard. They don't mean to. It's hard. I'll just pay the bills. So now if he's paying tuition $45,000 a year, he has to be not emotionally attached. He's emotionally attached to the tuition. The problem is that's for the school, but your kid needs a parent. You're talking emotionally attached, but they need emotionally attached to them, not just to the money you're paying for the tuition. So you could freak out Friday night when they don't have a Dvar Torah, when you're paying $16,000 a year tuition and they can't even tell you one Dvar Torah between the soup and the kitchen chicken, and you want to know why you're paying so much tuition. They could stay home on the video games and it'll be cheaper. You want to know why I'm in such a good mood this morning? Huh? I'm going to have to go back to the father and the mother, figure it out. Yeah.
Is there a way, according to Chassidus, to identify what is a child, what is a father, a mother, how to peel it back?
How does one track back?
Sometimes you don't want to go there because you want to keep damage control. You don't want to... You want to make it worse.
No, there's no question. Yeah. Sometimes a person is just lost and there's complete and they're just damage control and I'm scared any move I make... Right? It's like they say, stay put and just don't do anything. Whatever you do is going to be wrong. And your child will make sure.
You identify.
But that itself, I have to identify. And that's why we need relationships. That's why we you know, tshuva b'rov yoyetz. A person needs friends. A person needs mentors. Aseh lecha rav. Or k'nei lecha chaver. Whatever that means in every person's life. We need to be able to have honest feedback. In terms of identifying exactly... That's a gansa on the sugya. How do you even begin to identify? We'll see a little more about that later. But here we're talking just the general idea that it has to be identified. And that doesn't make you weaker. You never have to be afraid of that. On the contrary, it makes you stronger. Because when you take responsibility for something, you have a relationship with it. You can own it. It doesn't make you a weaker person. It makes you a much stronger person. You become aware. Because awareness, the Baal Shem Tov said, all exile and redemption is about awareness. It's about das. It's about knowledge. It's about perception. We'll soon see what das means exactly, even deeper than that. But that's where galus and geula begins, because that gives you choices. As long as there's no awareness, there's no choices. I'm just crippled. When there's awareness, I can now make a choice. I may not get rid of the emotion ever, maybe never, but I can make a choice.
Havdalah is in dance.
Yeah. He says in Yerushalmi, why did they put Havdalah in Chayin and Hadas? Atachin Antanu, Mitzray Shabbos, Mitzray Yomtev. We say in the Bruch, Atachin Aladam Das. Why? Why there? We're saying Atachin Talmater Secha, Mavdal Ben Kodesh L'chol, Ben Er L'chol, Hashem makes Havdalah. Why does it belong in Atachin Aladam Das? And for the Gemara in Yerushalmi Brachas, im ein das, havdala minayin. If there's no das, there can't be havdala. So it looks like this is a very deep idea. There's no choices. Havdala means there's a choice. You separate. That's what choice means. Choice means.
Huh? The Marishan, from eating from day to day.
Yeah. Im ein das, havdala minayin. If there's no das, you can't separate because you have no choice. You're just in one big bubble in a concoction that there's no havdalah. If there's das, atachoinin ladam das, chaneinim itcha chachma, bina vadas, And we'll soon see here the focus is, even though we mentioned Chachma and Bina, I mean, it depends on the Nusach, there's different Nuschayas, but not only Das, but the Yerushalmi focuses on Das. It made Das, Adon. Because in Chachma Bina itself, the key issue is going to be Das. The key issue in this whole process that we're talking about, we're now dealing with Das Tachta. We're not dealing with, nothing of this is Das Atliyan. We're all dealing with Das Tachta now. But this process of identifying the father and the mother, taking responsibility for it, owning it, seeing the connection, respecting it for what it is, and being aware of the process, being aware of that process, then you can make a choice. And you can make a choice. We'll see later in the Maimon, the Balatanya is going to quote a whole story from Masechet Avodah Zarah. It's almost a whole Amid. It's a significant part of the Amid of Masechet Avodah Zarah. It's one of those stories in Shas that gets your mind thinking, and you're scratching your head to try to figure out how people could speak this way, what it means. And it's a story of Avodah Zarah, Daf Yud Zayin. We'll see the last paragraph of this page. The Baal HaTanya is going to go and explain, based on this idea of what Das is, Das Tachta, a whole conversation between Rabbi Yossi ben Kisma and Rabbi Yochanan ben Tradyan, moments a little while before Rabbi Chanina ben Tradyan was killed. Hafla of a fella, a mamish, absolutely stupendous, unbelievable, how one of those stories in Gemara between two of the Tanoim, or the greatest Tanoim, which was dealing with very serious moments before one of them was killed by the Romans, Rav Chanina ben Tradyan, one of the Sorei Malchus, and his friend and his teacher, Rav Yosef ben Kisma, gave him an insight that at the surface, like, how do you speak like this? But he's going to show that they lived with Das. They always lived with Das. Because they always lived with Das, this comment was not just tolerated, it was welcomed by him. It was really welcomed by him. As we will see in the Hemshech of the Maimer. So at this nekuda, this is always the nekuda that you could always learn when it comes to your child. You never disown a child, ever. Chalila v'chas to disown a child. The idea that some people think that at some point you disown a child, you sever a relationship with a child, is a colossal tragedy. You never ever sever a relationship with a child. You may disagree. There may be pain. Right? Unconditional love doesn't mean uncritical love. Unconditional love doesn't mean that I'm not pained by a behavior. What I feel is destructive or wrong, or I know is destructive and wrong, but doesn't mean I'm not going to love you. And that's it. I don't own you. Because not owning you means I'm not owning me also. We're one. No such a thing. You don't amputate.
Opposite of owning is love.
Huh?
Opposite of owning is love. It's disown it or you love it. You can't own it and not love it.
What do you mean own it? I don't know what you mean own it.
It's a child. Disown it.
You don't disown a child, yeah. You're always connected to a child. Doesn't mean you agree with everything. Doesn't mean you spoil. Doesn't mean there's no discipline, but it means you're always connected.
How do we deal with Yishmael?
How do we deal with Yishmael? You have to deal with Yishmael? If somebody has here a child, Yishmael?
As a concept, we do. As an idea, we do.
Yishmael. You wonder why Avram Avinu didn't follow this shir and he disowned Yishmael.
And he got direction.
So first of all, one sees that Avram Avinu fought it.
Right.
In other words, Mitzad Avram Avinu didn't make sense to send away Yishmael. Yeah. Hashem told him, so he did it. So anybody, if Hashem tells you to send away your child, gesund to hate. But wait. He didn't only send away Yishmael, he sent him with his mother. If you're sending away your child, no problem, but do it with his mother. Send him with his mother, which will be better for her too, to get away from you. And not a bad idea. So just remember, you don't just send away a boy, you send away the boy with his mother. That's fine. Send him away the mother. Gesundheit.
She's talking about the mode of the emotions.
Yeah, spiritually.
Number three, this is before Matan Torah. Let's remember that too. Number four, Yishmael didn't even have a gedder of a Yid. Wasn't a gedder of a Jew. Kibi Yitzchak Yikari L'chazara. Number five, it says in Pirkei de Rebbe Lezer, it says in Rashi, that when Avram Avinu passed away, who buried him? The pasuk vayikbaru Isai, Yitzchak v'yishmal. How did Yishmal show up to the Levaya? He got a text message. What does Rashi say? Malamed? Sha'asa tshuva. How did Yishmal do tshuva? What happened? So it says in Pirkei Rebbe Elazar, Avraham Avinu would go visit him. Hashem said, send him away, but he'd go visit him. Because it was the whole Maisa. He came, and he was his wife was Fatima. Fatima, yeah. In the Muslim world, that's a big name. And Avraham Avinu was very impressed. There was one wife, and then a second wife, very impressed with the hospitality. Yishmael came home, and she described him who visited him, and he was very moved that his father came. So even then, Hashem told him, but Avraham went to visit him. And then suddenly, the next generation, Yitzchak has a son, Esav, who was no greater tzatzka than Yishmael. What should have been the first thing Yitzchak did? Send him away! The tata. The Messiah is you throw out kids of the house. That's the Messiah. Your own father did it. Suddenly, what does Yitzchak do? Not only not throw out Esav, Esav married two tzatzkas, but Tiena, I don't know what the right word for it is. I don't want to say machshefes. Okay. Two shiksas, fine. And what were they doing? As it says in Rashi, they were smoking up Yoimam Valaila, right? It's a Rashi. And not smoking up to their gods. And the positive about Tiena Moira Sruach, Li Yitzchak Ulrivka, people think Yitzchak was some naive saint living in heaven. They were a cause of agony for Yitzchak. He should have thrown out Esav with his daughters-in-law. Go buy, here's money, go find yourself an apartment, leave me alone. Go get a job, you're a hunter, go get a job. He doesn't do that. L'chayra, you have a father of Ramavin, he had a mother Sarah, look what they did, they threw out Yishmael. Hashem said, that's the right thing to do. And suddenly Yitzchak changed course completely. Esav remained with him. And not only Esav, Esav had a son, Eliphaz. What does Rashi say in this week's parsha, you remember?
Yeah.
Yaakov cried when he met Rachel. Why did he cry? He said, when my father had to have a shidduch, Eliezer came to the girl with 10 camels loaded with wealth and richness. 10 camels. Wasn't enough one camel. Wasn't enough one diamond ring, one tennis bracelet, 3 mink coats, 4 homes in Switzerland, Yerushalayim in Florida. Right? And Muncie for Shabbos. 10 camels. 10 camels she got. Rivka had to have. And I came with him with garnished. Kibamakli of Artius Hayardin. Yaakov came with a stick. That's what he owned. He owned a stick when you go on a hike, you know, you make a stick. That's what he had. Kibamakli of Artius Hayardin. So what happened there? Yitzchak couldn't send him a couple of dollars. You can't give Yitzchak, you're sending him for a shidduch. Give him episode, he has to impress somebody. Nadin, something to give, start off a life. Nothing. So Rashi says, he went with a lot of money. Yitzchak was a wealthy Jew. Okay, the Avanezer time is that Yitzchak lost all of his wealth. But the Pashtus Yitzchak, Yitzchak was wealthy. It says he was very much liach, vayigdal ha'ish me'asharim. The pshat is, Esav, who was furious with Yaakov because of the story of the brachas, had a son, Eliphaz. And he sent Eliphaz to go pursue Yaakov and kill him. Because Yaakov fled. And Eliphaz found Yaakov. And he came to Yaakov and he said, I gotta kill you. Daddy said. So Rashi says, Ulefi shegadal b'cheikoy shel Yitzchak. Because Eliphaz grew up in the bosom. B'cheikoy means in the... on the lap, in the bosom of Yitzchak, in the shoyz, yeah, that's exactly the translation, in the shoyz of Yitzchak. In other words, Yitzchak, we would say, Yitzchak cradled him, so he couldn't kill Yaakov. He just couldn't get him. He was a ben bayis. He knew Yitzchak. He knew Yaakov. He couldn't kill him. So he tells Yaakov, I have a problem. You know, in our family, kibudav. In our family, kibudav trumps everything. Daddy said. So Yaakov said, come, I'll give you a shear. And Yaakov gave him a shear in Masechta Nedarim Daf Chaf, that Ani Chashav Kemeis, that a broke, destitute person is like that. And he taught him the Ran, and he taught him the Rishonim, and he taught him the Acharonim. He probably even taught him the Shmuz or Reb Chaim Shmulevich on that Gemara and Sichas Musar. And Eliphaz said, Geshmak a shear? Let me take your money. And he took his money, and that's why I'm broke. That's the story. Now understand this. Eliphaz is a murderer. You give him a shear to Masechet Nedarim. Yeah, imagine, yeah? You meet a murderer, you say, wait. Ani, the Gemara says in Nedarim, Ani Chashav Kames. So why don't you... Really? That's what you do with murderers? They're interested in Masechet Nedarim Dav Chav? And it worked. It worked. He comes to kill him. He takes all his money, but doesn't kill him. The answer is, this was the tragedy of Eliphaz. Eliphaz was a son of Esav, and who was he a father of? Amalek. Eliphaz was the father of Amalek. And as a positive departure by Yishlach, Eliphaz lived with his mother and he lived, married his daughter. Everything in that family was one big incestuous relationship. This was Eliphaz. So an apple doesn't fall far from the tree in this case. Esav was no saint, and Eliphaz took it to the next level, and he was the father of Amalek, and we all know who Amalek is. You would think, Mela, your son, you have to tolerate. But your grandson, throw him out of the house. Gadol Eliphaz b'cheikoy shel Yitzchak. He had him on his lap. This Eliphaz. So you could say, okay, he hoped he'll make a mensch out of him. But he didn't. The guy became a Rosh Marusha. And that was it. But wait. We're alive today. Why are we alive today? Because Yaakov wasn't murdered on the way. Why wasn't he murdered on the way? Because Eliphaz remained with Yitzchak. So Eliphaz might have not become Rabban Shel Kol Bnei Hagoyle and a great tzaddik, but ultimately the entire Jewish people are alive today, and they owe their life to one thing, that Yitzchak did not throw out his grandchild from the house. And if you'll open up Parshas Sefer Iyov, you'll see, I think, Perek Dalet or Perek Vav, Vayan Eliphaz Hatemoni, one of Iyov's friends is Eliphaz, who consoles him after the death of his children. And Rashi says, Eliphaz? So Rashi says in Iyov, Kivon Shegadol B'cheker Shel Yitzchok, I think the Lashon is Sharsal of Ruach HaKodesh. Eliphaz had Ruach HaKodesh. Eliphaz was full of Mamzedim in his life. He himself was not a very kosher child, as Rashi explains in Mayishlach from the Gemara in Sanhedrin. He had Ruach HaKodesh. Why? Because it's a Chidrei Tarum Yitzchak. And this is the short answer to your question. Yitzchak should have said, you saw what happened with Yishmael. Esav Meila have to tolerate Rivka, whatever. This. Now usually fathers do it because the mother wants. But Rivka was actually into Yaakov. So Yitzchak had a carte blanche, he had a green ticket, go ahead. Learn from it. He did the exact opposite from his father. Interesting. Very interesting. He did the exact opposite. And he was Midas HaGvura. Gvura is the Chmidas HaDin. I'm not a chesed. I'm not love. I'm truth. Yeah? What did that rabbi say? I'm not politically correct like everybody else. I say emes. I say the emes. I'm not politically correct. I don't flatter people. Yeah, I'm Gvura, I'm the real thing, I'm Midas Adin. Vayev Yitzchak, Vayev Yitzchak is Esav. And this is Esav. This is Esav, from whom Klal Yisrael doesn't come. Kol Shekein V'Kal V'Chaymer, after Matan Torah, when it says, Ata V'Chartona Mikol Ha'amim, and every Jew is a Chelik Elekam Imal Mamish, and Le'idach V'Meno Nidach. The Chatova Poshet B'Yoyser B'Yoyser. And if you really feel you got to throw him out, no problem. Just make sure he has his mother to do his laundry and make him cinnamon buns and chocolate chip cookies and cradle him and so on and so forth. Then you go take care of yourself. if your mamash have to action zechah. I'll call panim anegel in yanenu. Let's finalize. So just like when it comes to a physical child, to it comes to a biological child, the same is true with midas. I don't have to ever disown. But says disown, sinisht mine. Don't be afraid of your midas. Don't be afraid. It's there. It's fine. Don't worship it. The less you're afraid. People say, if I'm not going to be afraid of it, I'm going to follow it. No. On the contrary. If you're afraid of it, the monster grows. If you're not afraid of it and you could look at it with a certain respect and a certain curiosity, you can actually see what is going on, and you can actually help dissolve a lot of it. as we will see in the Hemshech of the Maimer. The Weizik is verstanden.
There's definitely things from a child that you can't control, that it is from God, it doesn't have a father or mother.
Sometimes I have to accept certain things. I can't change everything. Sometimes I have to accept certain things. Verstanden? Verstanden mit Das Seuche, dann mit Mensch, hat doch beginnen. Hakel bedei Shamayim, Chutz Meir Shamayim. The Koyach of them, but the Poyalet had a lady clip. Yeah, but the Koyach of them comes from the
This class is brought to you by the yeshiva.net. Please help us continue the classes. Make even a small contribution at www.theyeshiva.net/donate.